we had these three studio albums before, Bubbles and Bones, Princess, Love Bites, where you're in the studio, you have your headphones, you have that world, and we did parts in London and New York and Basel, and that was important then. We wanted to do that. We wanted to have the cities to influence our blah, blah. But for Suicidal Yodels, it was somehow we started in the studio with the headphones and yo-lo-lo. It's so weird yodeling with headphones in a black studio. Mm-hmm. It made no sense. Yeah. So after about an hour and a half, it didn't take long to find out, let's go out, let's just go outside. So he took two of these condensed microphones with him. Mm-hmm. We put him outside on two spots, and I started doing my thing outside. Mm-hmm. Train stations, hotel rooms. That made sense.
Yeah.
Also the musicians, you sit different if you're in a hotel room than if you're in a studio waiting for a click or...
Yeah.
That...
What did you record it to? Onto a disc immediately?
Onto the laptop. Into Audiologic.
Yeah.
And then into Pro Tools.
Mm-hmm.
So it is digital, but with these two microphones that are...
Fat things.
These flat condensed... Flächenmikrofone, and that gave us this surround feeling. It's like movie music, like a Hörspiel.
So it was not your intention from the outstart, really.
That was pretty the start. I mean, it's not that we had everything planned and then we figured out, oh, we're going the wrong way. We just started. Let's start with one or two songs and see what happens. Mm-hmm. And right away, an hour.
Yeah.
We even thought, let's try, it might not work, but then feeling this studio on my, I don't know, it didn't smell right.
Yeah.
And then as soon as we were outside, he said, I got you, this is it. It just made so much more sense. And then you're back in the studio because you have these main tracks with the train on it, with the kids screaming on it, and of course you can't erase those, but you can always put a little violin here, a little to make this softer.
Yeah.
You can always play around with it as a producer, but these main tracks are, if you don't like your voice on it, too bad, you know?
Yeah.
And you have to let go of so much vanity, so much Eitelkeit, like, I wanted to get ta da, and now it's ta da da, I want ta da, and he's like, yeah, sure you did, but, you know?
It's like
a model that says, I don't want that camera, I can see my this and that. You have to let go of so much vanity bullshit. And that's also good for the project and for the end result.
And you don't regret that at the end of the project?
Nope. No, you get recompensed in so many other ways.
Yeah. Is that how you deal with projects? You know, there are certain things that you won't be able to have and certain things that you will surprise you, so you...
Yeah.
You know.
Especially in filming, I've learned to accept borders and hope for gifts. Except, okay, this is not working. Now let's see, maybe we'll get something totally else out of it.
Yeah.
And then whoosh, there comes a helicopter. It's like, yes!
Yeah.
We were doing this sumo thing in New York. New York skyline. I'm doing King Kong! And out of nowhere, this helicopter comes in the back.
Yeah.
I didn't even see it while I was doing it.
Yeah.
And now on the film, each time I see this helicopter, it's like, thanks!
Yeah, that was the moment you wanted.
Ah, thanks! Yeah, that was the King Kong moment. Where can you get a, you know, if I would have had to buy that helicopter?
Yeah.
The people around me are more jazz. Maybe that's why, since I started out with Ray Anderson and Art Barron, those were clearly, but even those guys say, I don't know if I'm jazz. People diss me because I'm doing funk music, and the other one says, he was with Duke Ellington, okay, but now he's touring with Bruce Springsteen. Is that jazz? Definitely not. So everybody's kind of, I rarely hear a musician, even if it's some jazz festival in Finland, I rarely, rarely see a musician saying, I'm a jazz musician. George Grunz says it, the 75-year-old George Grunz. He says, I'm a jazz musician. But a lot of people have learned to spread their wings in so many different senses and areas that...
It's very difficult.
I often have a jazz audience, but that's maybe because jazz audiences are more used to taking chances, willing to hear things they've never heard before, more than a rock audience who would be disappointed if you showed a weird little movie.
Maybe it's because jazz is so infiltrated by other styles anyway, like rock, etc.
Mm-hmm.
That it's more acceptable. I mean, in rock music, it's influenced. Rock music is actually influenced by jazz. They just don't know it. Yeah.
The good ones know. They know.
Yeah, the good ones know.
Oh, yeah.
But in all music, there will be people who do know, but the majority don't. They just think it's rock.
Rock, okay.
You know, they don't even know that black people were the ones who created rock music. You know,
mm-hmm.
It comes from Chuck Berry and all those kind
mm-hmm.
of guys.
Mm-hmm.
So from that basis already, you have a problem when
mm-hmm.
you know.
But that's something we don't talk about. That's something we talk about when the camera's on or when the question comes off. We don't... I don't remember when I last talked about musicians. How many percent jazz musician are you? Or anything like that.
Mm.
It's not the question we ask ourselves. Sometimes you get asked from a record company, where should we put you? World music, rock, Jimi Hendrix? I can't put that into world music, or should I? And that's where I think, okay, I'm glad it's not my problem.
Mm.
But that's something I don't think about too much.
It doesn't really make a lot of sense anyway. People are going to hear your music, they're going to find you somehow,
mm.
aren't they?
I guess it makes sense when you're on MySpace and you have to figure out what of the 15 or 25 stamps goes to my music, then you have to decide. But otherwise, I never have to decide. Nobody ever really asked me to.
What do you do?
I get that. I get the what do you do, but I don't get the how many percent jazz musician are you too often. What do you do? I get that. They do ask me that. And then I try to explain about
how it's constructed or...
Yeah. I understand
influences.
The question too. I mean,
influences,
I could,
isn't it? It's influences.
It's influences. I remember there was a time when I was younger, I would say, not my problem, what I do, your problem. I just give it back. And
yeah.
Now I'm... Altersmilde, I'm getting older, I'm kind of thinking like, well, they're trying to put me out to an audience. Give them some help, you know.
Right.
Just give them a little help.
Yeah.
Don't, you know.
Don't make it more difficult than what it is.
Yeah, just try to say what you're doing. I believe if I would have focused on that the last 25 years, I'd be there. There were so many directions and decisions that I took not to
be there.
And very often it was also a question of gut feeling or the people by the table, oh, they're from a major, you want to meet them? Okay, hi, and then, ugh, do I want to have a drink with them? No. Okay, and that's it. That stopped already there. It's like, I should have a drink with them because they're important and they're powerful. And they're. If you always follow this gut feeling right away, feeling like, do I want to sit here next to this guy? Nuh-uh. Hi, bye. So those are millions of decisions that you take. If I wanted to be there, I'd make those phone calls. I'd go there, I'd drink with those guys. I'm not saying they're all terrible and vultures, but you feel it. You feel,
yeah.
And then this guy, oh, he's so sweet, he's nice, who is he? Oh, this small record
mm-hmm.
label in Berlin, really? I want to drink, let me finish this beer with him. And then wrong decision, girl, wrong business decision.
Mm-hmm.
You should have. For me, it was always the right decision to have a drink with the lady from Berlin, from Traumton, and not with this other hotshot from Britain that came in and
right.
came to see me, and
yeah.
which is nice, but you smell it.